Bismillah, walhamdulillah, and welcome to part 2 from the particles of the composition of a salat. And in the previous, or part 1 at least, we spoke about the increase in numbers. And I said that they don't know when exactly it increased. And this takes me to speak about the loud and quiet salat. And this usually, every time you ask the question, why in Maghrib we recite loudly and Isha, at least the first two rak'at, and Fajr recite loudly, you always presented with an interesting answer, and this would, it's there, it's out there, and every sheikh would give it to you. They will tell you, the summary of their answer is this: while in Mecca, the believers were oppressed and persecuted, and for this reason, they were allowed to recite the Qur'an in their salat in their hearts, quietly, so that the Quraysh people and the disbelievers do not hear them when they pray. So that's what they say. But when they migrated to Al-Madin and they were free of oppression and persecution has ended and things like that, they were ordered to recite the Quran loudly. And it was just Fajr, Maghrib and Al-Isha. And with that answer raises another more complicated question. If when they are in Al-Madinah and now they are no longer scared of the oppression and persecution, all that kind of stuff, why are only parts of the Salat loud? Fajr is, both of them is loud, I understand the recitation of the Qur'an. But why has Dhuhr and Asr remained silent? Why the two rak'at of Isha have remained silent by the end, 3 and 4? And why the third rak'ah of Maghrib has remained silent? And now Muslims are not persecuted. So what's the problem? What's the thinking behind? And it just makes no sense. However, now I will give you the real reason as to why some parts of the Salat are loud and other parts of a Salat aren't. Because it's really interesting, my dear sisters, and this has nothing to do with the oppression and persecution, but rather it's because of the lack of information about how the Messenger of Allah prayed when in Mecca. And there are two reasons why we do not know that. If you want to see the life of the Messenger, you only know a little about it, Quraysh oppressing him and things like that. But you know nothing, even though he lived in Mecca 53 years. But we know nothing, and 13 of these as a messenger. But we know nothing of that, and people didn't speak anything about his life. But the real reason as to why, because we are suffering that embargo, information embargo that was hit or that was established on the life of the messenger when he was in Mecca. And the first one, my dear sisters and my brothers, is that the people, the Sahaba, the companions, when they embraced Islam and they became for 13 years, it was not an Islamic prerequisite to write down what the messenger did. The people did not record his biography. All the Sahaba, from Abu Bakr to Umar to Uthman to Abdullah ibn Mas'ud to Ali ibn Abi Talib, and I can name a huge number of them, none of them was telling other people about the life of the messenger, because it was not part of Islam. At that time, all that matters is the Quran comes from Allah. Yeah, that's good. And then how we should practice it, and that was that. None of them had ever, it's hadith, Rasulullah said. And of course they tell you, it was Rasulullah who forbade them from writing the hadith so that it does not get mixed with the Quran. And this is another attack, and this is an act of shirk. If what comes out from the mouth of the messenger is as good as the Quran, why do we tell people then that Allah revealed the Quran and the Quraysh could not produce anything like the Quran? Muhammad could, and he does it. Of course, all this is a lie. The reason why Rasulullah did not ask his companions to write anything but the Quran, because anything but the Quran wasn't Islam. The only Islam that was the Quran. And then later on, the second point that has really restricted our knowledge about our messenger is the embargo, the information embargo that was established by Banu Umayyah, Muawiyah, the enemies of the Messenger of Allah, and then later on Bani al-Abbas. And I will not dwell a lot on this point here, but it will be on the book, because all this talk will be changed into a book, and you can read about some history about why we did not do that, and the recording of the biography of Rasulullah and how it took place in the second century, almost 70 years before they started writing the hadith and things like that. So at the end of it, my sisters, the reason the scholars talk about this salat and why some of them are loud and some of them are quiet is not because the added ones were silent. It's not that. And look at it. When you look at your salat, Dhuhr, I'm going to take Dhuhr, okay, the quiet one. The rak'ah number one, you recite the Faatiha and you recite some Qur'an behind it. Rak'ah number two, you recite Al-Faatiha and you recite some Qur'an behind it. It's good. So the two rak'ahs are the same. Yet in the third rak'ah, you just recite Al-Faatiha. And the fourth rak'ah, you recite, you wing it. No more Qur'an, what? Third and fourth rak'ah of Dhuhr and Maghrib and Asr and Isha and things like that aren't like the first one. We don't recite the Qur'an, we just recite Al-Faatiha. Why? What's the reason behind it? And I will tell you the reason behind it. In the third century, in part number one, in installment part number one, I mentioned a couple hadiths about the companions remembering salats of Rasulullah that they had forgotten, either deliberately or they just forgot it. So the companions had lost part of the salat. In the third century, when they wanted to document al-Islam that we have today, they saw something different. There were people who were only praying three prayers throughout the day. They were praying Fajr, Maghrib, and Isha. And they were praying this rak'ah, this salat, two. Fajr two rak'ahat, Maghrib two rak'ahat, Isha two rak'ahat. That's it. And they found others, they prayed Fajr two rak'ahat, Dhuhr two rak'ahat, Asr two rak'ahat, Maghrib two rak'ahat, Isha two. Really? And they saw other people praying our prayers the way we pray today. Fajr two rak'ahat, Dhuhr four, and Asr four, and Maghrib three. And they could not understand why this great number of people from different parts of the Muslim world were praying this different. Why would the people of Iran, which at that time were Sunni, by the way, it was not Shia. Sorry for this definition of Sunni and Shia. I don't believe in it, but it's a political definition, just for you to know. At that time, Iran was not Shia. And people from Somalia, from North Africa, everybody was praying a different prayer. So the Abbasi kings and the government wanted to unify the Muslims on one type of salat, because there were lots of arguments at that time as to which salat was right, which salat wasn't right. When the fuqaha, the jurisprudence, sheikhs, men of religion, scholars, things like that, when they wanted to write down, they were faced with huge challenges. Challenge number one. And then I will get back to the Fatiha later. That's why we recite it in every surah. They made it compulsory part of the salat. I'll speak about it when I talk about al-Fatiha. But they got to a point where Dhuhr and Asr, where big number of people did not believe that Dhuhr and Asr were part of the salat, the daily five, the daily prayers. They don't exist in Quran, and why should I pray them? Other they say, oh, the Prophet prayed them. Well, they go to the Prophet, he prayed them like Sunnah, like he would pray Duha, like he would pray Maghrib Sunnah, Isha. They go, if he prayed, it's his business. But that is not what Allah made on us. And then there were the other arguments, and then they of two, and the increase of the number of rak'at and all that kind of malarkey there. And then with time, the school of thought, the Hanbali, as they call it, the Ahl-Sunnah, the Sunni school of thought, took over the Hanbali. And what they decided was, Fajr stays two, Dhuhr becomes four, and they made it part. And that's why they say you the pillars of Islam, five, and then you have to pray. And the whole invention of the Isra and Mi'raj, ascension to heaven, and how Allah gave us the five daily prayers, and all those stories is to push the agenda that there are five daily prayers on every single day. And this is the politics of Al-Islam. That's why I'm telling you today what we are following. We're following an Islam that has been designed for us, not what's in Al-Quran. All right? Because Al-Quran speaks about three prayers only, Fajr, Maghrib, Isha. And I'll talk about this when I cover this type of topics about the Salat. But for now, let's stick with our points. I don't want to go right and left and then lose track of what we are saying here. So when there was all these arguments, and when Asr was debated, it's not part of Al-Islam, what they did, they say, if you do not pray Asr, all your daily actions will be voided, will be zero, you get nothing. Really? And they even have invented the hadith, whoever misses Asr, فَكَأَنَّمَا وُتِّرَ مَالُهُ وَآلَهُ, as if he has lost all his fortune, his wealth, and his family. Asr. Why this? Do you think Rasulullah said this? No. But it's the invention so that people pray Asr. It's to force people to perform Asr. Then every element that we can go back to as if it happened or not has been taken away. So we stuck today with Asr, unless we go back to the Quran and we go through the timings to find out exactly. And Alhamdulillah, people have done. And as I said earlier on, I will speak about this point, the five daily prayers. Are they really five or are they three? And are they this and are they that? More in details as we go along. So this will speaks to us about the number. So the addition and the loudness and not the so loudness of the different parts of the Quran. And I will speak about what we should recite when we read Al-Quran. So how did the Prophet pray in Mecca? We have no idea. We really have no idea. And of course, when you go back to the sheikhs and scholars, as usual, the amount of confusion is unbelievable. It really is, and that shows you just how little information we have from the days of when the Messenger lived in Mecca. And the disagreement between scholars, my dear sisters and my brothers, is enormous. If Christians wanted today to prove to us that our Islam is just a bunch of confusions, they can. Wallahi, they can. It's so incredible. We have differences about every single thing that you can think about. Let me give you one that you think is taken for granted, right? But there is a debate, there is a disagreement between the scholars about it. When did the Messenger of Allah migrate from Mecca to Al-Madinah? Each one of us will tell you that he migrated in year 13, right? Wrong. In Al-Bukhari, we have one hadith that tells us that he migrated in year 10, and the another one that says that he migrated in year 13. And to cut this argument so that people don't stay on it, don't dwell on it forever, our sheikhs had agreed to go with the 13 and disregard the 10. But it's still in the books of history. It's still in the books of hadith that the Messenger of Allah migrated from Mecca to Al-Madinah in year 10, which says that he lived in Al-Madinah 13 years. But if he migrated in year 13, then he would have lived 10 years in Al-Madinah. Even this, there is disagreement about it. So what about the rest of it, my dear sisters? It's incredible. Wallahi, it is incredible. I don't want to get much into this because I will cover it in my other talk, my other series, as to why I do not accept the hadith as authority in Islam. And I will speak about this kind of things then, because then it will be more appropriate to discuss the evidences. And I have the hadith, everything. I just don't want to mention them here. So I want to keep the talk folks. So when and where and how was the Salat prescribed? There is a very, again, compelling and pressing question that requires a huge deal of attention from us, and we need to give it that attention. When was Salat made obligatory? Meaning, was it made obligatory before the night of Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj journey? If before the night of Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj, then how did the messenger pray then? And we've already established that we don't know how he prayed. And also the manner and the number, all that kind of stuff. Was it with the same number of rak'ah different to us and we know it's different? And again, the salah that you prayed today, when was it made compulsory? There is a first, second, as usual, and third argument on this. But let me bring you what Sheikh Al-Munajjad, the supervisor of Islam QA, answers about this very particular question. One was a salat made obligatory. He says, he mentioned a hadith reported by Bukhari and Muslim that is widely known in the Salafi dogma, that they say that, by the way, any hadith reported by Bukhari and Muslim together are the highest degree possible of authenticity. As a matter of fact, a hadith in Bukhari by itself in the Salafi dogma is enough, really is enough to replace the Qur'an. Subhanallah, al-haq, la ilaha illallah. So when a hadith is Bukhari and Muslim, both of them, then they will win over the Qur'an. And this is in the Salafi dogma. They believe that hadith in Bukhari and Muslim supersede and overtake the Qur'an. Nowadays, it no longer is the Qur'an that overpowers the Torah and Injil, i.e. the rulings in Al-Qur'an supersede and higher, and the latest then is the upgrade to a Torah Injil. No! The Qur'an itself is beaten by the hadith of Bukhari and Muslim. And that tells you the level of disbelief we live in these days. But anyway, let's go back to the Sheikh of Islam QA and listen to what he says. He says, Anas ibn Malik reports that the Messenger of Allah said, the hadith is very long and it's just a translation, but I'm going to just take from it what we need for our talk. But the rest will be discussed when I speak about Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj. Then the messenger said, then Allah revealed what he revealed to me when he was in the seventh heaven and prescribed 50 daily prayers day and night. On my way back down, I met with Moses. And he asked me, what did your Lord prescribe upon your Ummah? And I said, 50 Salats. Musa said, go back to your Lord and ask him to reduce that. Of course, you know the hadith, the Prophet Muhammad kept going back and forth, but until at one point he got to 5, and Musa still told him, go back to Allah and ask him for less. Your people cannot pray the 5 daily prayers. And then the Prophet Muhammad said, I'm really shy and timid and I can't go back to Allah. And then he said, Prophet Muhammad, that he heard Allah saying, Ya Muhammad, even though there are 5 prayers that we have now, but in reward there are 50. Okay, and I'll discuss this more later in the next upcoming installment. But according to Al-Bukhari and Muslim, the Salat was in this night, that was given in this night. Then the Salafi Sheikh, as I said, the supervisor of Islam QA, added, scholars unanimously agreed that the 5 daily prayers were not made obligatory until this night. And he means the Isra and Mi'raj night. End of quote, end of his things. Then the question to ask my dear sisters and my brothers, when did Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj take place? Because this creates another problem for us. And the answer will surprise you, because nobody knows for sure when Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj took place. It's incredible. Wallahi, it's incredible. There is a huge disagreement between the men of religion, i.e. the scholars, about the Isra and Al-Mi'raj journey. When was the exact date? Which year was it? Nobody knows. And even if we try to establish an accurate history of this so-called miraculous night journey, we will have difficult times, because what happened in that journey is scattered in an incredible number of books all around. The only sure piece of information regarding this so-called night journey, Al-Isra, is that it took place before the Prophet migrated from Mecca to Al-Madinah. Anything else, my dear sisters and my brothers, can be disputed and challenged. Briefly, here are the dates so that you know the big problems we live in. 1 year, the first saying of this is that Isra and al-Mi'raj, the night journey, took place in year 12, i.e. 1 year before the migration of the Messenger. And this argument is held by Ibn Hazm. Ibn Hazm is a scholar from Spain, Andalusia, and he claims that all scholars agreed upon this. Of course, anyone who wants anybody to listen to him has to stick that it's everybody's agreed on. It's everybody on there. But of course, as you shall see, it's not the case. Saying number two, that it took place in 1 year, 3 months before the migration, and that it was in Dhil Hijjah. And this is also supported by Ibn Faris, one of the early scholars of Islam and well-respected in the Salafi school of thought. The third saying, or third point of view, is that it took place 1 year, 5 months before the migration. And this one here is reported by As-Suddi, and it's also by At-Tabari and Al-Bayhaqi. And they say this took place in Shawwal. The fourth argument, or the point is that it took place 1 year, 6 months and a half. That means 1 year and a half, and this is held by Ibn Kathir in his tafsir. Point number five, 3 years before migration in year 10. And they say it was in Rajab. And this was mentioned by Ibn Abdul Barr, a great, great scholar of hadith in the Islam, in the Maliki school of thought in Northern Africa. And also by Ibn Qutayba, and An-Nawawi fully supports this argument that it was 3 years before the migration, i.e. year 10. Number six, they say it was 6 years before immigration, i.e. in year 7. And finally, the number seven is they say it was in year 5. In the after the beginning of Al-Islam, and this is held by Az-Zuhri and Al-Qadi Iyad Al-Qurtubi, and also An-Nawawi supports this argument. By the way, it's very common that one scholar is reported to say so many different contradictory arguments just because the way the cookie crumbled before and how the scholars were before, the lies, it's incredible back then, Allah, it's incredible. So here we are, where we have seven different opinions. 1 year, 1 year, 3 months, 1 year, 5 months, 1 year, 6 months, 3 years before the immigration, 6 years before immigration, and 5 years before immigration. So at the end of the day, the people that are celebrating the Isra and Mi'raj in the night of the 27th of Rajab, they are just blindly following a very uncertain date decided by humans in the past, a long gone past, and we have no clue, no idea when Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj took place, and which also means we have no idea when the Salat was prescribed. We also have no idea if the Messenger had prayed because of what Allah said or because of what he thought. It's incredible. I'm starting to have a headache just because of the number of confusion. But anyhow, to cut through this mess, they invented a rule. Because with all this, if you go and speak to a sheikh, in a court of law, if a murder took place and the medical doctor cannot establish at what time did the body die exactly, with different hours, different sometimes, like as you heard, it's year 5 and the other one is year 7 and the other one is 18 months, 15 months, 12 months. And if different people come with different testimonies in a court of law, the case is dismissed. Because you can't build an absolute truth on so many contradictory elements. You can't do that. But what can you say? This is our problem. So to cut through this problem so that the scholars are not faced with, they invented a rule. That rule is this one. If there is a dispute between the Salaf, the predecessors, the righteous predecessors, the scholars of the past, and there is no evidence which tips one argument over the other. So like we said, like the 8th one, anyone could be right. Or maybe it's not all of this. It could be something else completely different. But they say if that is the case and we don't have anything that would help a case or a point against the other, and then what they say, and if people, i.e. the general public, follows one of the argument and that opinion, receives an acceptance. For example, people decide, you know what, let's believe it's year five. And then people start celebrating year five, and then year five becomes the year of the ascension to heaven, the Isra and the Mi'raj. Then our scholars say that if people have chosen that, then it is likely that their choice is correct. Oh, yes. It is likely that their choice is correct. And this is exactly how you put Islam at the mercy of mankind, not a religion from Allah. Needless to say that this rule contradicts the Qur'an 100%, because Allah orders us in Al-Qur'an, وَلَا تَقْفُ مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٍ, and do not pursue that which you have no knowledge of. Why, Ya Allah, do you tell us not to do anything without knowledge or follow anything without knowledge? إِنَّ السَّمْعَ وَالْبَصَرَ وَالْفُؤَادِ, the hearing, the sight, and reasoning, thinking, كُلُّ أُولَٰئِكَ كَانَ عَنْهُ مَسْؤُولًا, all of that, i.e. the hearing, the sight, and the reasoning, shall be called to accountability on Judgment Day. Meaning, on Judgment Day, if you do something out of ignorance, Allah will call upon you on Judgment Day and will question you, why did you do it with ignorance? I have commanded you not to do anything except with full knowledge of it. So my sisters, as you can see, and my brothers, as you can see, our scholars have resorted to this horrible rule. But why did they do that? Where did they get what encouraged them to say, if there are so many different views, but people of a country decided that, you know what, let's go with option number 6. And then they start practicing it, and then that option becomes part of the religion of Allah. What made them say that? Well, there is a hadith that is reported by Ibn Majah and At-Tabarani and others. And even though this hadith is weak, but it is applied. My ummah, inna ummati lan tajtami'a ala dalala. My ummah, my nation, my followers, this is Prophet Muhammad talking, will certainly not unite on a misguidance. So the Muslims will not unite on a misguidance. فَإِذَا رَأَيْتُمْ اخْتِلَافًا, therefore, when you see a difference in arguments or in opinions, فَعَلَيْكُمْ بِالسَّوَادِ الْأَعْظَمِ, then follow the great majority. Would the Prophet say this with the Qur'an that he knows? If I am a total idiot when it comes to, in comparison to Rasulullah, and I can derive that this cannot be true because Allah says not to do anything without knowledge, then certainly the Prophet of Allah, the Messenger of Allah, would know a billion times better than I do. And this is a good example on how the Qur'an is abandoned for a hadith, human-made hadith. Therefore, my dear sisters and my brothers, when they say that the Salat was prescribed during the Isra and Mi'raj journey, the question to ask is, how come Salat became compulsory and obligatory on the believers in Mecca, while nobody, none of those companions, knew when exactly the incredible night was? If you tell me that the Salat was made compulsory when Al-Isra al-Mi'raj took place to heaven, how come the companions, none of them, recalls when a Salat was made compulsory? It's incredible. It would make your head spin. And that because all scholars of Islam, from the biggest of them to the smallest of them, know exactly when Ramadan and Az-Zakat were prescribed. And they don't have any disagreement or difference of opinions about this. All books, all scholars, everybody says that Ramadan, fasting, and Zakat were prescribed in year 2 after the Hijrah. But when you ask them about As-Salat, which is more important because As-Salat is something we do on a daily basis and it's ritual, it's a protocol of communication with Allah. We should know everything about As-Salat. But when it comes up to As-Salat, we don't know nothing about it. When it was made compulsory, why we add rak'at, why this one is loud, why it's not light, we have no clue. Why? Because people have contradicted the Qur'an so openly, and only if they study the Qur'an, we would have had the answers to our questions. In the third installment, I will discuss in details Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj. So please get ready for more surprises then. But for now, let's just move on to the next point. Ibn Kathir in his tafsir says, on the night of Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj journey, that is 1.5 years before the Hijrah, because according to Ibn Kathir, it took place in year 11 and a half, because a year and a half later, the messenger migrated, not year 10, as Isil preached. Ibn Kathir doesn't see it year 10, he sees it year 11 and a half. But anyhow, he says that Allah prescribed upon his messenger the 5 daily prayers, then gradually, meaning Allah, explained the conditions of a salah, the pillars and everything, the essential parts, little by little. This is in Tafsir Ibn Kathir, volume 7. And I say, what Ibn Kathir said doesn't help at all. Especially after I mentioned the difference of opinions of when Al-Isra'an journey took place and things like that. And it puts us Muslims in a very, very awkward situation. Our Salat, our most precious Salat, according to what the Sheikh say, if you don't pray one Salat, you are a kafir. We have no clue of when it came to existence. But the Ramadan, which we fast once a year, the Zakat, which we donate, we give once a year, we know the exact date, and we even know when. Do you think this has any logic in it? My dear sisters and my brothers, As-Salat was not revealed to the messenger, but it was taught to him by Jibreel. You heard right. Yes, the Prophet Muhammad did not receive As-Salat as a revelation, as the Qur'an, as the fasting and zakat. But it was Jibreel. I'm telling you what the books of history say. When I get to point number 4, the fourth installment, you will know how Salat was given to Prophet Muhammad and how we prayed and everything. But I'm telling you just what exists in the books of our history and our sheikhs and everything. They say that As-Salat was given to the messenger, was not revealed to the messenger, but taught to him by Jibreel. Here are a few hadiths about this matter. They say that Umar ibn Abdul Aziz akhara as-salat yawm, that Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, which they call is the fifth Khalifa, and he's an Umayyad king, he's got nothing of the Khilafa, but because he was a little bit better than the other tyrants of Banu Umayyah, he was given a lot of credit, and he was actually over inflated by our sheikhs and everything. But anyhow, so Umar one day delayed the prayer. And again, this Umar ruled in year 99, and then he was killed in year 101, and he was poisoned by his own people. فَدَخَلَ عَلَيْهِ عُرْوَ بْنُ الزُّبَيْرِ فَأَخْبَرَهُ. So Urwa ibn Zubair entered upon him and informed him that Al-Mughira ibn Shu'ba akhara as-salata yawman wa huwa bil Kufa, that Al-Mughira ibn Shu'ba delayed the prayer one day when he was in Al-Kufa. Basically, Umar ibn Abdul Aziz delayed the salat. Another man called Al-Mughira walked on him and gave him an example of the wrong that he was doing, that somebody else did exactly the same thing as Umar did. So Umar ibn Abdul Aziz asked, so what's that, ya Mughira? What happened then? He goes, do you know that? So this is now the man teaching the king. He says, أَلَيْسَ قَدْ عَلِمْتَ أَنَّ جِبْرِيلَ نَزَلَ فَصَلَّ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. Don't you know that Jibreel came down and prayed? So Jibreel performed the salat, and the messenger of Allah prayed, performed the salat before, after Jibreel. And then that's it. So this is for Fajr. At Dhuhr time, he came back again. Jibreel came back again and performed the Dhuhr. And then and the Prophet Muhammad performed Dhuhr behind him. And he did that for each and every Salat. And then, as they said, then the Messenger of Allah said, Bihadha umirt. With this, I was ordered. I.e. the way Jibreel prayed and the way I followed Jibreel, this is a command from Allah, and by this, and this is what I have been ordered, and this is how I pray. I wonder, did Jibreel teach Rasulullah what to say when you make ruku'? When you make ruku', Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, as we say, in our sujood? Or did we just teach him the position, the standing, the bowing, and then putting the head? Did Jibreel teach the messenger the tashahud? Of course not, as we shall see. So what did exactly Jibreel teach Rasulullah? What? Since anything in As-Salaat is a matter of dispute. What exactly did he teach? What did he teach him? Because if Jibreel came and taught the messenger, and the messenger in Mecca taught it to the companion, because they were little number, so he had an opportunity to teach the Salaat to them one by one. Or they saw him at a very reduced number, and then these people would have taught it to the others, and we learned the good Salaat. But that is not the case. Each and everything in Salaat is a challenge, is a dispute, is a matter of difference of opinions. So what exactly did Jibreel teach our Prophet Muhammad? But anyhow, so let me carry on. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz then said to Urwa, "Unzur ma tuhaddithu ya Urwa. Consider what you are telling. This is not something simple. So you're making a claim that the Jibreel taught the messenger, and this Umar ibn Aziz became a king in 99 Hijri. That's almost 100 years from the death of Rasulullah. And he had no clue of what the messenger was taught by Jibreel. If this is the king, and if this, so what do you think of the rest of the people? Tons of people had no clue of this. But anyhow, and then Urwa carries on, he goes, that Jibreel came down himself, and then he made Iqama, and he prayed with Rasulullah, and at the beginning of each Salaat, Jibreel used to come to the messenger. And this hadith is in Bukhari and Muslim. So based to the Salafi dogma, this is an authentic hadith, and this is how a Salaat started. And I say, this is a very unknown matter to people. The king didn't know. The books of history and hadith, they always say that Umar ibn Abdul Aziz was the fifth Khalifa. Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, and Ali, all of them, may Allah have mercy and be pleased with them. All of these people prayed, but Umar ibn Abdul Aziz don't have a clue on how they prayed. The next hadith will open up another gateway of understanding to us. Jabir ibn Abdullah said, Jibreel came to the Prophet when the sun had passed its zenith and said, "Get up, Muhammad." That was when the sun had passed the meridian, like the middle of the sky, and has shifted a little bit, and that's for dhuhr. Then he waited until the length of a man's shadow was equal to his height. And this is again a dispute of the in the fiqh. When do we pray asr? When the shadow of anything is equal to that of its original. So if you stand and your shadow equals your height, then that is the time for Asr. Of course, the Hanafis, they don't believe this, and neither do the Maliki, but anyhow, that's another point for another day. But for this now here is that they say that the Jibreel waited until the height of something became the same as the thing. And then he came to Rasulullah and called him, "Ya Muhammad, get up, pray Asr." And then he waited until the sun had set off, that's it, sunset. And then he came, "Ya Muhammad, stand up, pray." And the Prophet prayed, and they prayed Maghrib. And same thing for Isha, and the same thing for Fajr. And this is, as they say, how Jibreel taught the messenger the Salat. And this hadith is in An-Nasa'i and authenticated by Al-Albani. So this is, as you can see, the different arguments about As-Salaat. And as I said, there is a plethora, there is a huge number of disagreement about this topic of the Salaat. In Musannaf Abdul Razzaq, and also in Ishaq, in the Sirah of Ishaq, and Ibn Hajar in his Fath al-Bari, they report another text. They say that this teaching of Jibreel to As-Salaat was in the morning after the night in which prayer was made obligatory. Al-Qurtubi said, and the scholars did not differ concerning the fact that the one who came down to teach the messenger how to pray was Jibreel. Ibn Taymiyyah said that Jibreel also showed the timing to prayers to the messenger, as if the Qur'an hadn't done that. And I say, I wonder, what kind of Salaat again did Jibreel teach the messenger? Since Ibn Kathir said, then gradually, i.e. after that, Allah explained its condition, the pillars, the essential parts, bit by bit. So what exactly did Jibreel teach the messenger? And more importantly, why didn't Jibreel teach the messenger what Allah was gonna do later on? Why didn't he give it to him right ahead? Why did he teach him something extremely simple? and then things start getting complicated. This is an extremely important point. Important because Ibn Kathir said Salat started simple, like with the least amount of things to do, then throughout the years, Allah increased it, improved it, added to it. And this doesn't make sense whatsoever. Either Jibril taught the messenger all the salat that we required, or he didn't. It's not like, okay, I teach you a little bit, and then with time, we're gonna increase it. One other extremely important point, and that is, since Jibril came down and taught the messenger how to pray, that means the messenger, just like you and I, was only following Allah's instruction, nothing else, no sunnah, no hadith. Just like Jibril brought down the Qur'an, he also brought down a salat. Just like Jibril taught Nuh alayhi salam how to build the ship, Nuh had no idea, there was no ocean, never seen an ocean. When the time came to build the ship, Allah sent Jibril to teach him. So now let's move on and let's look at the Salat forms, because it's common belief between the men of religion that the daily five prayers were only two rak'at at the beginning, and then they got added after the Hijrah, as I said, once they were in Al-Madina. Then of course they said Allah revealed a Salat simple, and then with a time the Salat started getting complicated until it got to how it is today amongst us. Of course, all these are not true. But let's go to what our mother Aisha, Allah be pleased with her, said. She said, Salat was prescribed two rak'at, for that is Salat rak'atayn. Then the messenger migrated, and it was prescribed four rak'at, mahajar al-nabi, fa-fulidat arba'an. But the Salat while traveling remained as it originally was, i.e. the Fajr two rak'at, Dhuhr became two rak'at again, Asr became two rak'at again, Maghrib stayed as he was three, and Isha becomes two rak'at. Now, whether this hadith about the number of rak'at is true or not, that's beside the point. But what it is the messenger had nothing to say in the form of the salat or its timing or how we make wudu or anything at all. He was just following what the Quran says. Please keep this in mind, because later on, when I will, at the end, especially when I speak about the Quran and how it taught us how to pray, all this will come together. What I'm saying this, now you will get on, that's what he meant earlier on. As for the Salat being prescribed in the night of Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj, this is very, very untrue. It's not true at all. Salat did not exist way before the night of Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj. And if going by the hadiths about the Salat and things like that, which they say was prescribed after Al-Isra al-Mi'raj, we get contradictory, because some of them said that it did not exist before Al-Isra al-Mi'raj. Some others say, no, it existed. So what exactly happened in Al-Isra al-Mi'raj? What did we learn from why was the Prophet taken all the way up to the seventh heaven and be given a Salat? What exactly of that Salat was he given? Again, I'll deal with this in installment number 3, inshallah. People are losing faith in the way Islam is run today. Because take any subject, a Salat, a Zakat, Hajj, marriage, divorce, business, and all that you want. If you want a fatwa, all you have to do is go around and look for a person that's going to give you the fatwa that you're looking for. This is what people call fatwa shopping. So if someone divorces their wives and they want to get back, and even though they did everything to divorce, and once they get there and they hit, oh my God, I've divorced, there is no way back. Guess what? All they need to do, go look for a sheikh, a scholar, a school of thought and opinion, and guess what? They back to square one again. Of course, this will not surprise you, because when I mention what I'm going to mention about the Salat and all the fights around it and everything, you're going to realize that even now you are praying a prayer, a Salat, that has been designed by a school of thought, and that what you are doing in that Salat is not necessarily done in all other salats. For example, you take part, say the Hanafi, they believe in such a way when they pray, but when you go to the Shafi or the Maliki, they don't do that. They believe that that's nonsense, that it's not part of Islam. And that's why we have in our Islam today one issue, but so many different arguments. And this, of course, makes the idea, if the Qur'an by itself was enough, how did we then learn how to pray? Extremely, extremely demanding, and we need to know how Allah has explained to us in Al-Qur'an how we lead a salat. As I already mentioned, there are so many examples, but I'm just going to take the rule of some scholars are of the view of this or the view of that. And at the beginning of Islam, they say the Salat was just 2 rak'at in the morning and another 2 rak'at in the near sunset time. And others, they say no. But let me start with what Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani says. Ibn Hajar is from a city called Asqalan, and he's a Palestinian scholar, and he existed 773 years in the Hijri, meaning that about 700-800 years ago. And until today, we follow his school of thought, and Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani is really the true composer of the Sahih al-Bukhari. He became famous once he did his commentaries on Al-Bukhari, which is Muqaddimat Al-Bukhari or Hadyu Sari fi Sharh Sahih Al-Bukhari. But anyhow, he says that a group of scholars are of the view that before Al-Isra, there was no obligatory salat prescribed at all. And that salat was just offered at night without any number of rak'at specified. What he's saying is that the messenger and his companions would just stand up and would just pray whatever number of rak'at and then end up finish, and that's that. But Al-Imam Al-Harbi, who was born in around 200, two centuries after the death of the messenger, and died at the end of the 3rd century, he says, and he was also considered Shaykhul Islam of his era. He said, As-Salat was made obligatory, 2 rak'at in the morning and 2 rak'at in the evening near the sunset time. So there we go, we have 2 points of view, and you go shopping. You see, sometimes you have a simple issue that you want an answer to. But when you go to a sheikh and or you search in the internet, you find a whole different so many different points of views. So much so that even after you read, after you research, after you do everything you do, you end up more confused than when you started. And that is why people today are not the Muslims that they should be. It's just because the way Islam is preached, she's so out of this world. Okay, now that we have discussed the loudness and quietness of a salat and the 2 rak'at and all that kind of stuff, we're gonna start with the first big point in our salat, and that is the recitation of Al-Fatiha in As-Salat. And I mean in each and every rak'ah. For example, if I take Dhuhr, you recite it in all 4. And the first 2 rak'at you recite it, and then you read Qur'an after it. The issue of reciting Al-Fatiha has been disputed since the early days of Islam, and I mean the 2nd Hijri century, because before that they didn't write any of these arguments. And this dispute is still going on in our times, and you still hear questions about this. If is reciting the Fatiha compulsory or not in a salat? What if the imam is reciting loudly? Should I read it or should I not? The answer to this question will depend on who is answering it according to which school of thought. The hadiths about this topic are many, and most are self-contradictory, and they contradict with each other. And so when you have sheikhs, a sheikh will take from this part and the other one will take the other side, and they end up contradicting themselves. Here is an example of this issue. The Egyptian Al-Azhar High Fatwa Council in Egypt answers this question in there. When they are asked this question, they will tell you the following. The Hanafi school of thought. The Hanafi is of the view that the person praying behind the imam must not recite at all behind the imam. even in the quieter salat, such as Dhuhr or Asr, and the other parts of a salat, like the third rak'at of Maghrib and the last two rak'at of Isha. So according to the Hanafi school of thought, if you are praying behind the imam, you must not read at all. You just stand there and the imam does the reading, and whatever the imam does is yours. And then they say, when the imam reads the Qur'an loudly, the follower in a salat must listen. And if he reads the Qur'an quietly, then the person following the imam must just keep quiet, read not a thing. And their evidence for this is a hadith. They say that this hadith is reported by Ibn Majah and authenticated by Al-Albani, which makes this hadith authentic. They say, man kana lahu imam, whoever is led by an imam, or whoever has an imam, the recitation of the imam is his as well. So they say, based on this hadith, you really need to do nothing. In the books of hadith, you read the following about this hadith. This hadith was reported by 8 companions, i.e. it's not only authentic, but super authentic, if I can say that. And they will say that this is narrated by Jabir ibn Abdullah, by Abdullah ibn Umar, Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, Abu Huraira, Abdullah ibn Abbas, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Anas, and Ali ibn Abi Talib. As you can see, it's the hadith is authentic, authenticated by Al-Albani, and narrated by 8 companions. So this should be enough, right? It should be enough for any other scholar. But then again, you are left at the mercy of the sheikh. And which sheikh is going to answer your question? So if the sheikh is of the opinion that Al-Albani and the great number of scholars who consider this hadith authentic, as sahih, and especially on the Hanafi school of thought, then guess what? That's what you should do. You should go to your salat and you stand there behind the imam like a robot, like a statue, and you do absolutely not a thing. And your salat is fine, is corrected, and everything is cool. And then they tell you, there is the second school of thought, or the second opinion in the issue, and these are Al-Maliki and the Hanbali school of thought, heavily present in Saudi Arabia, and the Maliki school of thought is heavily present in North Africa. They will tell you that this school of thought, the Maliki and the Hanbali, are of the view that it is not obligatory for the follower, for the one who is behind the imam, to recite Al-Fatiha, whether the Salat is recited loudly or recited quietly. So there you are here, you want to do it, you don't want to do it, you don't want to do it. As opposed to the Hanafi, don't do it. Their evidence for this, they will tell you the same thing. They will use the same hadith used by the Hanafi school of thought. Whoever is led by an imam, the recitation of the imam is his as well. And they say, yeah, entirely up to you. Even though the Hanafi have deducted that, no, you should not do this. There is, however, a third school of thought in this, and they are the Shafi'i school of thought. The Shafi'i scholars, the school of thought, and they exist also in Egypt, they are of the view that reciting Al-Fatiha is obligatory on the imam as much as it is also obligatory on anyone who is behind the imam, be that loud or quiet salat. And if you don't recite the Fatiha, then your salat is not accepted. And their evidence is the hadith is in Bukhari, Muslim, Ibn Majah, Abu Dawud, and other books of hadith. And the hadith is authentic. Well, they tell you that the Messenger of Allah said, لا صلاة لمن لم يقرأ بفاتحة الكتاب. There is no salat for he who doesn't recite with the opener the Fatiha of the book. And with that, if you don't recite, then you've got nothing at all in your salat. And in another hadith also they mentioned that this hadith is authentic as well, or the chain of narrators is authentic, reported by Ibn Hibban and Ad-Darqutni. The hadith says, لا تجزي صلاة لا يقرأ فيها بفاتحة الكتاب. The salat, or the prayer that we pray, is not complete, is not perfect, is not accepted if one does not recite in it the Faatiha, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim. Now, the most correct of this opinion is the one that you see, once, there you go. We've got three opinions. The Hanafi, you do nothing. The Hanbali and the Malikis, it's not obligatory, but you recite it. It's good to recite it, you got the reward. The Shafi'i school of thought, they tell you, nope, you don't recite the Fatiha, your Salat is not accepted. Here I am presenting this question to you. What is the status of someone who prays and does not recite, or should they recite al-Fatiha, or shouldn't they? And watch how people go in fights. And this issue has been going on and on for the last 1400 years. And we sick and tired of this. Has Allah had any point of view of this? Does He say something about this? Why didn't Allah say anything to help us get out from this kind of problems? But guess what? Allah has spoken. Really has. And I will explain in a little while what Allah has said about this issue and why what Allah says is absolutely gorgeous. Let me first start with what Al-Hasan Al-Basri, also highly respected in the Salafi world. He mentions that in the opinion of the majority of scholars in Al-Basra, in Al-Iraq, and is also highly regarded in the opinion of Al-Mughira ibn Abd al-Rahman al-Makhzumi al-Madani, who is considered as the highest authority in fiqh or jurisprudence in Medina and Maliki and all that stuff in that era. And he was born in the 124 the Hijri and died 186 Hijri calendar. They say if the worshipper reads Al-Fatiha once in any Salat, that is more than enough for his or her Salat to be accepted by Allah. And by doing so, is not obliged to redo their Salat because it is a Salat in which Al-Fatiha has been read. That's it. So subhanAllah, Al-Hasan al-Basri, now one great number of scholars of his time, and Al-Hasan al-Basri has lived with the companions. He was grown up literally with our mother Aisha, and he's a closer member of her family. And he said that the scholars of his time say that if you recite Al-Fatiha only once in any Salat, let's say you pray Dhuhr and you recite it once, then that is enough. That you shouldn't recite it in every rak'ah. But once you know the reason why they say all this about Al-Fatiha, why all this mess about the Fatiha recitation, you'll understand that actually it's not Al-Fatiha per se that is important, but what it hides behind it. The Hanafi school of thought is of the opinion that the recitation of Al-Fatiha is obligatory in the Salat. However, they added on this rule that though Al-Fatiha recitation is obligatory, but it doesn't play anything into the acceptance of the Salat. And that's because this obligation is only dictated by the Hadith, i.e. the Sunnah. The Hanafis do not accept the evidences coming from Hadith only. It needs to come from Al-Quran. But they have hadith that says something like that. So what they are saying is that if someone recites Al-Fatiha, they will get reward and the Salat is accepted. But if someone does not recite Al-Fatiha, they will not get the reward, but their Salat will be accepted. Unlike the other ones, especially the Shafi'i, that say you must recite Al-Fatiha. And today, worldwide, it is preached that you must recite Al-Fatiha for your Salat to be accepted. The reason being, it's Saudi Arabia. Because the Hanbali school of thought or the Wahhabi school of thought are of the opinion that each rak'ah must have Al-Fatiha in it. If you do not do that, then your Salat is not accepted. And because they have the petrodollar, the money, and they spread Wahhabism around the world, financing Islamic institutes, masajid, sheikhs, and all that kind of stuff, their school of thought is predominant. And that's why we have what we have today. And I say, my dear sisters and my brothers, but once you know the reason again about Al-Fatiha, you'll understand why. But let me tell you what Allah says about this. And should you recite Al-Fatiha in every rak'at or not? Allah says in Al-Qur'an, فَقْرَأُوا مَا تَيَسَّرَ مِنْهُ. So read of the Qur'an as it is easy for you. Meaning, if you know lots of Qur'an and you want to read lots of Qur'an in Salat, so be it. If you don't know lots of the Qur'an and you want to read just a little bit, that is fine. So what Allah is telling us, that when you stand in a Salat, any part of the Qur'an that you recite will do. You don't need to stick to the Fatiha by itself. And now I'm going to tell you why all this mess, why all this noise, why all this hoo-ha about Al-Fatiha. In the 3rd century when they wrote Al-Qur'an, when they transcribed Al-Qur'an on paper, they had few arguments about some parts of Al-Qur'an, and they disagreed about are they part of Al-Qur'an or aren't they part of the Qur'an. Very two specific parts of the Qur'an were discussed. The last two surahs, قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ and قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ, and that's why they put them at the far end of the Mus'haf, and Al-Fatiha at the beginning. Al-Fatiha and قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ and قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ, according to some companions and lots of other scholars, these three, what's part of Al-Qur'an, are not part of Al-Qur'an. They are just a dua that were added to the Qur'an. And that's why in the Mus'haf of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, the companions who was with the Messenger of Allah in Mecca, and he lived all his life in Al-Madinah with the Messenger. And as a matter of fact, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud is one of the four people that the Messenger of Allah told us to take our Islam from them. So Abdullah ibn Mas'ud does not consider قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ and قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ to be part of the Qur'an. Ubay ibn Ka'b, another man whom Allah the Messenger told us to take the Qur'an from him, also does not consider Al-Fatiha as part of the Qur'an. And the argument was so much so that there were people that were beat up and others were killed and all that kind of stuff because of this idea, of this opinion, of these arguments. I'll stop here because I've hit the hour, and I will carry on inshallah in the next part about Al-Fatiha.